Nicola Vicina from the University of Pisa. And today he will talk us about H1 scattering for long range NLS. So please, Nicola.
Okay, so first of all, thank you very much to Alessandro, Raffaele. Very nice invitation in Rome. And okay, I will discuss this result we have with Vladimir Georgiev concerning, in fact, this gauge invariant nonlinear Schrödinger equation. So the classical model, and with an initial condition, we are in Rn. So P will be the strength of the nonlinearity, N is the space dimension, and I underline that we work in the defocusing case. Okay, so you see the energy is positive. We have this sign plus, which is due to the fact that we have minus in front of the nonlinearity. And so this is a model where we don't have the solitary waves discussed by Scipio, but something interesting in any case happens. So what we say about this Cauchy problem? Well, the first question you ask yourself concerns, of course, the existence of a solution. Just let me mention the theorem. This is very, very classical. I think that the best reference to have all the complete bibliography is the book by Kazenav. And the hypothesis to have global existence is P larger than one. Let me put less than one plus four over N minus two if N is above three. No restriction from above if N equal one, two. Then in this case, we can say that there exists. So for every phi in H1, there exists one unique global solution. Just if I want to emphasize the dependence on the initial datum, I will write U sub phi of Tx, which is continuous in time, valued in H1. Okay, this is a rather classical result. I recall you that the critical case when we have here equal corresponds to the energy critical case, much more difficult, studied much later, first by Bourguin in the radial case of 3D, then by Colliander, Kiel, Staffilani, Tao, Takaoka, and then extended in higher dimension, and so on. But my interest is to talk about power which are small, so very far from the H1 critical situation. So I don't emphasize too much on this point. Just it's important to know that there exists one unique global solution. And the globalization is due, in fact, to the focusing character of the equation, because you prove, so the key tool to prove this result are just the keywords, Strichert's estimates, and a contraction argument, okay? For the Duhamel operator. I don't say nothing more because the main interest for us is the scattering theory. So to understand something about the long time behavior of these solutions. So let me come to the long time behavior. And here we have a very rich situation depending on the strength of the nonlinearity. Okay. So let me start by considering this range, P larger than 4 over n, 1 plus 4 over n, and smaller than 1 plus 4 over n minus 2. This is a regime of nonlinearities where you are between the L2 critical and the H1 critical. And here you have a very nice scattering theory. So we have this theorem that I just want to recall. In the form right now, I think in its generality has been proved by Ginibre and Velo in the 80s, but there were previous results by Lin and Strauss. There were other results in the space sigma, but here I want to give the best possible statement we can, one can prove, which is the following one. So for this set of nonlinearity, you have the following result. So what you do? You show, you can show that for every initial datum phi in H1, there exists uniqueness in this case is trivial, is easy. Two initial conditions that they call phi plus, phi minus, which still belong to H1, such that the following occurs. So the nonlinear evolution of the original initial condition can be compared asymptotically when time goes to plus infinity with the free evolution of the new scattering states, phi plus minus. What is important is that they start in H1, the scattering states belong in H1, and the topology where they go to zero is in H1. This is why we call this scattering the energy, scattering in energy case, because everything happens in the same topology. And the difference, one can show that goes to zero when time goes to plus infinity. So plus infinity, you have a behavior given by the free wave associated with phi plus, and with phi minus, you have the opposite in when t goes to minus infinity. Also in this case, I don't say too many things, just a few words about the key tools to prove this result. So the key tools are again Strichard's estimate, because we have already seen in the talk by Jacopo, by Schippe, that the key tool is to show that some Strichard's estimate global in space-time is finite. So Strichard's estimate is ubiquitous in this theory in some sense. The new word I want to add is Moravec's estimate, which is basically the new tool necessary to prove this kind of result. Just let me mention another fundamental contribution in this H1, in this super mass supercritical and H1 subcritical case, which is by Nakanishi, because this statement in dimension n equal to is due to Nakanishi. Okay, there was a serious difficulty to adapt to Moravec's estimate in the low dimensional case. So Nakanishi first solved this problem. I have to say that nowadays there are really very short proof of these results where you use an extra tool, which is the interaction Moravec estimates, which have been introduced by Collia, Del Chiri, Staffilani, Tao et Apoca to study the energy critical case. But just remember this statement, okay? Initial data in H1, if you are between L2 critical and H1 critical, in H1, starting from H1, you approach everything by a free wave. So roughly speaking, what means this fact? Well, this fact means that for large times, essentially, the nonlinear effect, sorry, does not appear, okay? And you also understand why, in some sense, this fact is easier to be proved when p is big. Why? Well, because you see, start your heuristic from small initial data. So if you are small, if you are good enough, you keep proving that this smallness is preserved in time. And when you are small, the a big powers makes the rest even smaller. So this is why, of course, the larger is the p, the simplest is to prove scattering. So you have a very complete theory. And just let me mention that there is a very important contribution here in the case equal. This theorem is very, very difficult, and it is a theory due to Dodson. And in the energy critical case, as I already said before, we have this result by, here we have Burgen first in the critical case, in the radial case. Then we quote the usual CKSTT, Collier, Kill, Staffilani, Tao, Takaoka, higher dimension, we recall Visa, and many, many other contributions. So in this supercritical setting, everything is okay. So let's go now to the mass subcritical setting, where the situation is more complicated and richer in some sense. So what happens in the mass subcritical case? So mass subcritical means that my p is above one and below one plus four over n. Okay. So in between 1 and 1 plus 4 over n, there is a very important power, which for n equal 1 is the Scipio-Kubik nonlinearity. But in general, it is this important power plays a role in any dimension. So there is this situation when we consider two cases. So we have a first case when p is between 1 and it is at most 1 plus 2 over n. So you see n equal 1, we are in the cubic case. And there is another situation where p is above 1 plus 2 over n and below 1 plus 4 over n. And this 1 plus 2 over n is discriminant for the scattering theory in the following sense. So what happens here? In this situation, there is a classical result due to, I think, Barab. It was also contained in another paper or book by Strauss. But in any case, it is well known since maybe the 70s that in this case, no scattering can occur. So what is the precise statement in this case? So one can prove one possibility to show, to state this no scattering result is the following one. So consider any initial datum phi, whatever it is, except the zero initial datum. Consider its global evolution that exists, because remember that the equation is well posed for every p below the energy critical nonlinearity. Subtract any linear wave, whatever it is the initial datum, compute its L2 norm, compute the Lim-sup when t goes to plus infinity, and this is always positive, even if the initial datum is smooth and compactly supported, and whatever is the free waves in L2. So no possibility to approximate in L2, which is a topology weaker than H1, if your nonlinearity is not big enough. Okay, I should spend now just one word to recall that the question when P is equal to 1 plus 2 over n is a situation when even if the L2 scatter does not occur, still you can describe the asymptotic by introducing the modified scattering theory. We already met today at least twice, once with Valeria, where she introduced with this logarithmic modification in the phase, and also in the talk by Scipio. So in this case, the important, the first contribution is due to Ozawa. Then I want to mention Hayashi, Naumkin. New proof, more recent, are due to Kato, but not Toshio Kato, but Yun Kato and Kusateri. And maybe others that probably I don't know. Ah, also Lindblad and somebody else. There are, and maybe also Freeman. There are many proofs of this modified scattering. These are the most classical ones. Honestly speaking, I don't know if this modified scattering nowadays is known in any dimension. I think that for the moment it is surely known in dimension 1, 2, and 3. I don't know if something is officially known in dimension higher than 3. But in any case, we are speaking about a power where in any case, the classical approximation with free wave is impossible also in L2. And so it remains here, another set segment of nonlinearities, which is P between 1 plus 2 over n and less than 1 plus 4 over n. This is the so-called long range mass subcritical nonlinearity, short range mass subcritical nonlinearities. Okay. And what is the situation in this case? Well, I don't know if Valeria is there, but I have to thank Valeria because more than 15 years ago suggested to me to look at a beautiful paper by Yajima and Fuzuki. And I remember she said, I'm sure you will enjoy this paper. She was completely right, because this is the kind of paper that you really love to see, because statement, sharp, you read, you understand, including myself, which is not always the case, and very elegant, and you cover all the segments, okay? And many times I thought about this result. Also, before COVID, I was in Japan visiting Professor Ozawa, and also that day we discussed about this Yajima Tsutsumi result. It is something that I really liked since the beginning. So thank you to Valeria that she's there. And let me give you the statement, okay? So the statement is the following. So in this range of, for this short range nonlinearity, they cover all the set of range nonlinearity. You have the following statement. Give me an initial condition which is more than H1. This is the sigma space. And I recall you that the norm in the sigma space is the norm of phi in H1 plus the norm of X times phi in L2. So you require H1 regularity, but at the same time, you require some decay at infinity of your initial data. Then, if P is between 1 plus 2 over n and 1 plus 4 over n, the full segment, there exists phi plus or minus, which in the statement by Tsutsuma Yajima, you start to lose something. They don't belong to sigma in general, but belong to L2. And what happens? Beautiful thing. If you compute, you phi tx, you subtract the linear evolution associated with phi plus minus, you go to zero when t goes to plus or minus infinity in the L2 topology. So you see, the nice thing is that you cover with one unique proof, also very simple but clever, the full segment. But the point is that you start from sigma and you converge in L2, okay? So what you want to do, well, you want to understand if this scattering occurs in a stronger topology. Okay, so the first easy remark is the following. For example, a remark, very easy. Well, scattering occurs surely in HS if S is between zero, which is exactly the statement by Yajima and Tsutsumi, and one, but excluding one. Why? Well, because, you know, by the focusing character of your equation, the H1 norm of U phi is uniformly bounded. So you just apply interpolation. And if you are bounded in H1 and converging to zero in L2, by interpolation in HS is okay. So what we wanted to do with Vladimir, where we want to understand this endpoint case, S equal one, which is our contribution in this context. So our theorem is that theorem that we have with Vladimir can be stated as follows. Well, the result that we prove with Vladimir is something like this. You take as a black box the result by Tsutsumi and Yajima. We don't prove once again the L2 that we take as a black box, we just upgrade the scattering. So the result is the following. Assume phi belongs to sigma. Assume, this is the first hypothesis. Second hypothesis, assume that you can prove there exists phi plus or minus in L2 such that U phi tx minus exponential I t delta phi plus or minus in L2 goes to zero. This result we prove for every p up to one, okay? So the bootstrap from L2 to H1 is true in general, but the point is that the L2 is satisfied only above four over n. Then our conclusion is that phi plus or minus indeed belong to H1, but this is really easy to obtain that phi plus or minus in H1. What is more involved, and in fact, we converge in H1. Okay. So in some sense, we have H1 scattering for initial data in sigma, which is a bit stronger than L2 scattering with initial data in sigma. Okay. Now, I want to mention before giving an idea of the group. Well, one word which I want to spend is about this result by Yajime Tsutsumi. I really recommend to look everybody to this paper. It's really, it's short, but very elegant and very deep. And Yajime and Tsutsumi, they don't work by using a strict assistant. The theory they do is an L2 theory, just an energy estimate once the pseudo-conformal transformation is applied to our to your solution. And they reduce the problem to show that the pseudo-conformal transformation of your solution U has a strong limit in L2 when time goes to zero. This is the main difficulty, but you do that without using Strickarts, nothing like this. Okay, this is why they succeed to reach the full set of nonlinearities, because there are other possibilities that I mentioned now, due again to Tsutsumi and also to Kazanath and Weisler, where you can prove something stronger, but in more restricted regime of nonlinearities, where you try to play again with Strickarts estimate, but numerology forces you to put some restriction from below on the P. Okay, so you get stronger scattering results, but for a smaller set of nonlinearities. Okay, so what we do with Vladimir is that at least in H1, we have recovered the full segment by Yajima and Tsutsumi. So let me, Yajima and Tsutsumi is essentially L2 theory. Plus, pseudo conformal transformation. Okay, now before going further to give an idea of how we prove this result, let me recall you another result again due to Tsutsumi 1 year after this result. So there is Tsutsumi. This result, so Yajima and Tsutsumi, I think that is 84. This result by Tsutsumi that now I mentioned is 85. Then we have Kazenav and Weisler in 92. And after that, I'm not aware of any contribution where this scattering information is obtained in a stronger topology, as close as possible to sigma topology. Okay. So what Tsutsumi and Kazanath and Weisler do, where they show the following. So the result says the following. So they want to try to put in the topology of scale sigma space. Okay, but what do you do? Well, first of all, they show the following. So they show that phi in sigma, you have P, which is from above one plus four over n, but from below, you cannot reach the 2 over n. You reach 1 plus another p that depends on n, which is a strange number, which I don't remember exactly. It is a solution of a very simple second order equation. And this number is 2 minus n plus the square root of n square plus 12 n plus 4 over 2n, which by elementary computation is always larger than 2 over n. So the range that they cover is smaller, but the result they prove is bigger, is stronger, because they show the following. So if phi is in sigma, there exists phi plus or minus, which remain in sigma. So already the regularity of phi plus or minus remains in sigma. And moreover, they prove that if you compute the linear action on the nonlinear evolution, and you subtract phi plus or minus, and you put here the sigma topology, it goes to zero as t goes to plus or minus infinity, which is really a strong statement, okay? But only in this smaller set of nonlinearities, okay? And as far as you know, the endpoint case P, you can allow equal the endpoint, the contribution of Kazenave Vares lays to give a different proof of the Tsutsumi result. With extra bonus, they reach the equal case. Okay. But Tsutsumi proved, first proved that in the full range, 1 plus Pn, 1 plus 4 over n, you have this strong thing. Notice that what is written here, of course, implies for free scattering in H1, because of course the sigma norm is larger than H1. And then since exponential minus it delta is an isometry in H1, then you can switch exponential minus it delta from the nonlinear evolution to the free wave. Notice that it is not clear whether or not it implies, and I think it is not true in sigma. Why? Well, because when the free group is computed at the sigma level, the second order moment grows quadratically in time. So it is not anymore an isometry. So to switch in H1, the exponential is an innocent operation, but to do that in the sigma is not clear. There are very, very few cases where this result is known, very, very few, very, very special, and you know, due to Bellu. In any case, I have discussed with Thierry Kazenave about this second formulation when you try to switch exponential IT delta. And in his opinion, which in turn is the opinion of Ginib, so whatever Ginib says for me is a Bible, the correct for physics at least, for the correct formulation is where you act with the linear flow on the nonlinear flow. But this implication is, of course, a natural one, but very far from being proved, even in the regime where the first scattering result is proved. Okay. But of course, if you are in H1, once you prove this result in the red box, then you can shift at least in H1 the exponential. So our result with Vladimir in this smaller regime of nonlinearities is follows from a stronger fact, which was already known. But below Pn, as far as you know, there were no results in the H1 setting. So,
in the regime between below Pn and 1 plus over n, you don't know this sigma stuttering in this form, is true or not?
No, nobody knows. For the moment, what we have in the full regime is at least L2 becomes H1. But we don't succeed to put sigma and switching the exponential on the left hand side.
But also in this form, no.
Other example contribution was trivial.
No.
Yeah, yeah. If you can prove this, it's stronger than H.
But you have some expectation on what happened.
Well, after 92, there were no results. So to have expectation is not, I don't know. I want to spend just later an intermediate problem with an intermediate difficulty, but still I don't know how to solve, okay? Concerning the L2 weighted part. But for the H1 part, I want to say just now a few words on how we prove this result. Again, if you want to do something in such a general setting for every P, you have to forget Stricker's LP, LQ, because they force you. I tried for a while, but it did not succeed. You have to remain in the L2 setting. So what we do is just L2 theory, but done in the appropriate way. Okay, so it's, but you need an idea, just put a couple of computation in the correct orders. So what we do? Well, let me try to do this. So first thing, is that, let me recall you the fundamental tool that we use, which is the pseudo-conformal transformation. So we want to switch from UTX to the pseudo-conformal transformation of W. So we will work in parallel with the word of the U and with the word of the W, depending on what we want to do, which is also what Yajim and Tsutsumi did. WTX is this 1 over T to the N over 2. We put the conjugate of U, compute time. So what happens at the large times in W corresponds to small times. We rescale also to X with X over T, and we put this oscillatory factor here. Okay. And what do we have? We have that if we have, this is a direct computation that everybody knows. So if I dt u plus Laplacian u minus u to this power is equal to zero, then w solves a similar equation. But you put in front of the nonlinearity a weight, which is 1 over t to the power alpha. That depends on n and p. And again, you keep these nonlinearity. Okay. What is alpha of np? Alpha of np is explicit. It is 2 minus n p minus 1 over 2. Okay. And now from this alpha, you understand exactly why this 1 plus 2 over n is a threshold. Well, because if you make an explicit computation, you see that one remark, 1 over t to the power alpha, it belongs to L1 as a function of one variable of the interval 0, 1, if and only if p is between, is above 2 over n. Okay, so if p is below, you lose this property of being L1, which is exactly the threshold such that below you don't have scattering, above you have scattering. Okay, so this is a the equation, and most of the work by Yajim and Tsutsumi is done at the level of this equation. Okay, so in particular, there is a very important energy estimate that they use, which is the key to solve this problem. So we have this proposition due to Yajim and Tsutsumi telling us that if alpha is exactly as above, then t to the alpha times the w, the gradient of w in L2 to the square plus the potential energy of W in LP plus one to the P plus one is it's supremum in time 14, 0, 1 is smaller than plus infinity. This is a fundamental energy estimate that they prove just by working on the equation solved by W. And this is also for us the key. Okay, so for us, what we heavily exploit is this one, the control of the part of kinetic energy, okay? For Yajim and Tsutsumi, it was important to exploit both the control of the kinetic energy and the control of the potential energy. For us, it is just enough, this piece here. Now we have this estimate, and now let me try to tell you what is the strategy we follow with Vladimir to upgrade the scattering from L2 to H1, okay? So. Proof of H1 scattering. So what is enough to prove? It is enough to prove that exponential minus I t delta u phi tx minus phi plus or minus what you want in H1 goes to zero as t goes to plus infinity. So you have to show that this time dependent function converges strongly to something in H1. Okay. Now, what we already know? Well, first thing, we know that the H1 norm of the nonlinear solution is uniformly bounded. So this function exponential minus I t delta u t x in time is uniformly bounded in H1. we already know by our hypothesis that you converge strongly in L2. So for free, you know that exponential minus I t delta u phi tx converges at least weakly to in H1 in phi plus or minus. So you see the fact that phi plus or minus from L2 it becomes H1 is trivial. And you already know that you have this weak convergence. But the difficulty is that you want to upgrade this weak convergence to strong convergence. So how to go to the strong convergence again in H1. And here we come back to what we learned when we are third year students in Pisa or everywhere in the world. And if you show that the norms converge in H1, then you prove strong convergence, okay? So to conclude the strong convergence in H1, it's enough to prove it is sufficient to prove what? That the H1 norm, exponential minus I t delta u phi tx in H1 converges to the norm of phi plus or minus in H1, respectively, when t goes to plus or minus infinity. If you prove this, you prove strong convergence in H1. So the difficulty is to show this, okay? And to show this, remember that the exponential minus I t delta is an isomer, so it's enough to prove that u phi tx in H1 converges to this phi plus or minus in H1. But remember that the H1 is done by the L2 part, which is already convergent. So it is enough to work with the gradient. So it is sufficient to prove that if you compute the gradient of u phi tx in L2, this converges when t goes to plus or minus infinity to the norm of the gradient of phi plus or minus in H1. Okay, so this is our aim, and this is in fact in L2, sorry, yes. This is exactly what we prove, okay? And this proof, the proof of this fact comes from a couple of lemma, okay, which are done in the L2 setting. So first lemma is the following. Well, for the moment, we don't touch the W. For the moment, W, the pseudo-conformal transformation, we didn't touch. And what we prove at this level? Well, we prove that this is something which probably is written somewhere, but we have to prove by ourselves by end. If you compute the gradient of u, you subtract ix over 2t times u in L2, everything at time t, it goes to zero when t goes to plus infinity. Similar computation show when t goes to plus infinity. So if you want to compute the L2 norm of this guy, is equivalent to compute the L2 norm of this guy. Okay, so then it is enough to show that the x over 2t, ut, again, phi, this is the nonlinear solution in L2, converges to the grad phi plus, let me work here with the time grad goes to plus infinity in L2 when t goes to plus infinity. So we are reduced to show this estimate where now, look, we changed the gradient that we could control with the weighted norm, okay? And how do you prove this fact? Well, in this case, it was very useful to have worked for a while with Nikolai Tsvetkov in a question where we studied the long time behavior of the moments of an LS. We gave an exact description of the long time behavior of the moments when t goes to plus infinity for solution to an LS. It was important because now I draw the same picture I drew when I did a seminar about this topic. So how do we prove this fact? Well, let's go with a picture, which is always useful. Here you have x, here you have t, And the last two, let's start to split their space time in the interior of a cone and exterior of a cone. Okay. How do you choose this cone? Well, this cone you choose depending on a parameter r, which is modulo of x equals r times t. So when r becomes larger, you get larger and larger cone that get, take the full space time. And what you do? You split your analysis into two parts. The internal part, but you see, in the internal part of this cone, x over t is at most r. So this is an L infinity function. So computing this L2 weighted norm of x over t inside the cone is essentially computing the L2 norm of u. But in L2, u converges to free waves. But for free waves, an asymptotic formula giving you exactly the behavior. So what you do inside, you exploit the scattering, okay? What remains to prove? You want to be sure that what happens for this quantity outside the cone has a small contribution, okay? Because then you have inside of the cone, you treat just by the scattering. Outside of cone, the moments contribute very, very little, and you conclude, okay? So here, small contribution. So what means in a quantified way this fact? This fact, in a quantified way, you want to prove this one. So you have this lemma. Give me any epsilon positive. I claim that I can choose a certain radius r in such a way that the cone is large enough. So there exists a radius r epsilon, but also a time t very large, t epsilon, such that if we compute the L2 norm of x over 2t in the exterior of this cone, this is smaller than epsilon if t is larger than t epsilon. So you see, if you so you see, in some sense, if you fix an epsilon, you accept large times because you want to do a limit when t goes to plus infinity. And you take the exterior of a cone large enough, then the contribution, this red part, is smaller than epsilon. So you just need to compute what happened inside. Inside you have the scattering. And thanks to a formula which gives you an exact description in the two of free waves, you arrive to compute exactly this limit and you get the gradient of phi plus in L2, okay? So how do you prove this lemma? Well, to prove this lemma, we come back to the pseudo-conformal transformation, okay? So the proof of this lemma was more or less as follows. Well, what happens? Well, it turns out that if you look at the structure, at your W, showing that this L2, this this moment far away of a cone is small. So x over 2t u phi L2 in the exterior of a cone, capital R. Okay, this is equivalent to show to compute the L2 norm of the conformal transformation W against the weight x in the exterior of a ball x larger than R. So you see the time dependence in the weight is disappeared. The cone which has a radii which change with time become the fixed cone. And you so you just have to show that the first order moment far away from a big ball in the W becomes small when time goes to zero. Okay, and so what you do, you apply the virial computation at the level of the pseudo-conformal transformation. Okay, so this is the trick. And the let me show you very quickly this computation. So how do you show that this quantity at the level of W becomes small if T is close enough to zero and R is big enough? Well, let's start by introducing a function phi, which is smooth enough such that in some sense, phi is equal to 0 for x smaller than 1, phi x equals to x for x larger than 2. You compute the usual rescaling function phi x over r times r. You call this function phi r x. And if you want to compute the L2 norm of a function far away of this ball, you just compute this virial, so density of phi r square times w tx square dx. Now, when you compute this time derivative, does not cease the fact that you have the original equation or the equation with the weight in front of 1 over t. Because the gauge invariance of the nonlinearity remains. So at the level of the first derivative, you have exactly the same computation with or without the weight 1 over t. So this is something up to coefficient, the imaginary part of the gradient of phi r square, u bar, grad u. Okay, so if you put absolute value, the dt of this function, so phi r square. Ah, yes, let's call this psi. So this psi r square, it is smaller or equal than what? Well, the gradient of psi r square, you have a contribution given by the phi r. You have the gradient of psi r. But the gradient of psi r, thanks to the scaling I have introduced, is uniformly bounded in L infinity. So this is bounded in L infinity. Then we have u bar grad u. You apply the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality again, and you remain phi r square w square. Sorry, this is w. This is w, 1/2. And then you have here the integral of gradient w square to the 1/2. Okay, so I start from a quantity. I find here exactly the same quantity, and I have here the gradient w square 1/2. That in principle, I don't know what to do, except that I already have the estimate by Tsutsumi and Yajima. So this quantity here remains integrable in time. So this is something that goes, this quantity here is more or less of the order tau to the minus power alpha, to the 2. And this is a function which is L1. It is even better than tau to minus alpha because I take square root, which is still L1. Okay. And now it is easy to see that you have an ODE arguments. And thanks to these ODE arguments and to the integrability of this function, you can conclude that the moment far away of a large ball for small time. So, how do you proceed now? First, you choose a time t small enough in such a way that the integral between zero and this t epsilon of tau minus alpha over two is smaller than epsilon. Once the epsilon is fixed, you take the trace at times t epsilon of w, which is in sigma. So if you are in sigma, if you choose a r huge but finite, far away of there, the L2 moment is small. So you have essentially an ODE with small forcing time and a small initial data, if you work properly with T and R. And so you conclude that this second order moment has a small contribution far away from R. You transfer this information from W to U, and you have exactly what you want. Okay. And this is essentially the proof. But as you see, you have to avoid using the Stricker's estimate. Here, there is no numerology to close, and this argument is not affected by the presence of the weight in front of the equations of the pi w. And I was really surprised to see that you can compute this H1 convergent using a moment virial computation, okay? But at the level of the w. Now, let me tell you just one word about about the part of the norm involving L2 weight. So what can we say about the contribution to the scattering this L2 weight? So as I said before, the strong form of scattering, which is proved in the smaller set of nonlinearities by Kazenavu Weisler and Tsutsumi is this form here inside this box. We don't know what to prove. But I also tried to convince you that to prove this second thing is really huge. Why? Well, because you see, exponential, in general, when you prove scattering, you compare at infinity quantities which are at least finite. Okay, you compare in L2, scattering in L2 means you compare autonomous, which are at least bounded. Then you want to show that they go to zero, the difference. But if you start with diverging quantity, showing that the difference is small, it's not impossible, but something huge I've never seen. So this form of this scattering theory like this is really complicated. I'm really surprised that Begu could find at least one example where it works. Okay, so what is a possible substitute that we have? Well, I don't say that this is the correct definition of scattering, but one possibility is the following. So problem of maybe intermediate difficulty is to show this. Well, you take your nonlinear solution, you subtract by exponential I t delta phi plus or minus, which are the one given by Tsutsumi, which are H1, in which now we know we converge in H1. I put this weight X, I compute L2, but what I do, I renormalize by dividing by T. Okay, now this is something that, this quantity here, the L2 weighted renormalized by T for the free waves is uniformly bounded with a non-trivial limit. So this is maybe a good notion of scattering. You are close to free waves in this topology. And what you can prove using again what I did before by showing that far away of a cone, there is no contribution for the first order moment is that this property is equivalent to show that phi, the scattering state has a regularity. Okay, this is something that we can prove, but again, in which cases phi plus or minus stays in L2 weighted, we can prove only in the regime treated by Tsutsumi and Kazenavu-Weisler. But I think that this problem here is an intermediate level of difficulty that maybe somebody can be interested in. But proving this at least guarantees this weak version of scattering, which has its meaning. I mean, it's okay. So I don't know. Maybe I stop here. Okay. So thank you.
Thank you, Nicola, for the very nice talk. So let's see if we have some online questions. Please, you can just unmute yourself and ask. Don't be shy. In the room, yeah, some questions?
No, I don't
know. Okay.
I'm just explain again what is known for the sigma topology. The result you just said that you are very surprised.
What?
You said there is a result which was seen for the sigma topology. But you said you were very surprised.
No. Begu.
Can you just repeat?
For some power P, which is moreover is L2 supercritical. So in the regime where H1 scattering is perfect, this convergence goes to zero without dividing by T. And
this is true for something.
A few P supercritical in a dimension between 4 and 5. I don't remember this. But what is surprising is that you compare infinite quantities, okay? And so I don't think that in this form, if you put a exponential I t delta in this side, I think it's really hard the problem without renormalization. With the T maybe, it's okay. But what we notice is that it is equivalent to the regularity of the initial data. Now the H1 regularity of phi plus was trivial. It was difficult to prove the convergence in H1. Here, what is difficult is to prove the regularity in L2 weighted, and then this is a byproduct. This is a this duality between L2 weighted and H1. So once it's difficult the regularity, once it's difficult to prove that the regularity implies scattering this topology.
Another question?
See, obviously it must be very hard to prove the same result that they did in each data in each one.
No idea.
Are there any, maybe if you put the rest, is there any general class where it is reasonable to expect?
Well, there are results where you, allora, there are recent results by Nicola Burk and Tom and Laurent Thomann, but they prove probabilistic results. For almost every something, they don't work in H1, but they show that if you are in this topology, this scattering is the same topology, but it is in negative Sobolev spaces. So there are results where you, you keep the same topology of the initial datum and the convergence is scattering in negative space, in radial case, they are deterministic. But for H1, really, I don't know any result in the L2 subcritical regime without even in a special radial case or so.
Do you think it's true?
Well, what they proved years ago is that there is a nice property that falls that if you are in H1, L2 subcritical, at least you can prove that the potential energy LP goes to zero, which in the supercritical case implies a scattering. But in the subcritical case does not imply this, but still was unclear that the potential energy goes to zero if you just take H1. But unfortunately, I mean, once you show that some LP norm with P above two goes to zero, you control an L2 subcritical quantity. If you don't escape, if you don't control something L2 subcritical, forget to do fixed point. So the good thing is that in H1, we could escape completely from the numerology that is needed if you think in terms of Strickers.
Actually, this is something connected with what you started to discuss. From an escaping point of view, weight L2 with X as a weight is equivalent to Sobolev space with negative S.
Yes. No. In the radial case, working in this homogeneous negative space, start there, you scatter in the same topology, but not H1. H1 is really huge. So we did a very small step, at least in the energy space, you scatter.
Some other question?
Yes.
Okay, Nicola, to comment, you essentially used this sort of finite speed of propagation of the first order momentum, right?
Yes.
Because for the mass, essentially, it's enough to be outside the ball for this kind of finite speed. For the first momentum, you need to be outside a cone as you, so you can, you know, it's enough to be outside the ball to have a small reminder of the first order momentum.
No, you have to prove that if time is large enough and the cone is large enough,
okay, yes,
then you just go to zero. You don't quantify.
You use a cone. You need to use a cone. Yes, be a large cone outside the ball.
I don't think it's okay. True, because in L2 you converge to zero. Yes. So in a ball you remain bounded. You go to zero,
yes, right,
and outside you have conservation of L2.
Sure.
What is nice is that this time dependence of the cone becomes a cylinder in the once you transform, and then you can play with the
period.
That's the idea. Okay. You just reduce the cone to the cylinder, and then ODE arguments.
Online, no question. Okay, so I think we can thank Nicola again.